Okay, so let's continue. So I want to discuss applications of the Gram-Schmidt process. It follows immediately from the Gram-Schmidt procedure that the following result holds. So I will simply state this as a theorem and skip the proof. Every finite dimensional inner product space has an orthonormal basis. I don't write down the proof. The proof is it's a finite dimensional inner product space, so it's a finite dimensional vector space. So it has a basis consisting of finitely many elements. Since it's a basis, it's linearly independent. Apply Gram-Schmidt process to that to get a orthonormal set. The fact that the spans are the same proves that this is an orthonormal basis also. Okay, so you can write down the proof on your own. I am more interested in applying this GS procedure to what is called as a best approximation problem. Okay, let's develop some machinery before stating this problem. So I have the following result, which will be useful later. Let V be an inner product space. And let's call U as the set of all vectors U1, U2, etc., UN. This is not necessarily a basis, but an orthonormal set of V. Let V be an inner product space and U be an orthonormal set. Orthonormal subset of V. Let's take an arbitrary element X and V. Arbitrary but fixed element in V, and define a vector U as a linear combination of these UJs in this particular manner. Define a vector U in this manner for a fixed X. Then this vector U satisfies the following properties. Remember, X is fixed. Okay. The first property is that X minus U, this vector, is perpendicular to span of U. The vector X minus U is perpendicular to span of U. What is the meaning? The meaning is that the inner product of X minus U with W equal to 0 for all W in span of U. It's orthogonal to every vector in the span of U. That's the first property. Property 2 is called Bessel's inequality. Which is the following inequality. The first one is an equation. What is norm U square? Norm U square is summation j equals 1 to n modulus of the inner product of X with UJ, the whole square. And this does not exceed the norm of X. that inequality is Bessel's inequality. So there is a formula for norm of u square if you know the coefficients, if you know the numbers inner product x u j, and this number does not exceed the norm of x square. That is the second property. So norm u square less than or equal to norm x square is Bessel's inequality. Property 3. If u is a basis for V, u is already an orthonormal set, so it is an orthonormal basis. If you have that condition also, then x equals summation j equals 1 to n x u j u j and norm x square, in that case is summation j equal to 1 to n modulus x u j the whole square. Okay. That is, if u is a basis for V, then x coincides with this little u that we started with. Once you realize that, the other two are straightforward. This is called the Fourier expansion of x with respect to the basis that we started with. Okay, so this one is called Fourier expansion of x with respect to the basis that we started, u1, u2, etc., un. And this is sometimes called Parseval's identity. Okay, so let's look at a proof. First, I must show that x minus u is orthogonal to span of u. U is this orthonormal set, so it's enough if I show that x minus u is orthogonal to each of these vectors. Span of u, anything in the span of u is a linear combination of these, and so this is enough. So let's consider. Let us consider u with uk for a fixed k.
You do not know u, if you do not have a different symbol, then it is easy to understand. Say u says u1, u2, u1 is a orthonormal set. That is the set we call it a u. On one element we call it a small u. So if you don't have the different symbol, then it's easy to understand.
So I'll change that everywhere.
I don't know, u is a single element, so how can it say basis?
Okay. So I'll replace u by v. That's confusing. Okay. So I'm just renaming the set u by b, script b. Okay. Proof. So for each ui coming from that set script B, I look at the inner product of u with uk. I have the definition for u, summation j equals 1 to n inner product x uj uj. I take the inner product of that with uk, but this is the first term goes out with goes out as it is. First scalar. Then I look at the inner product of uj with uk. J is a running index, k is fixed, and k runs between 1 and n. So when j is equal to k, that is the only term which will remain, all the other terms are 0. because it's an orthonormal set. Script B is an orthonormal set. So this is delta jk. So this takes a value 1 when j is equal to k, and in that case it is just x with uk when j equals k. This number is 1, all other terms are 0. And so what we have proved is that inner product x minus u with uk is 0 for all k. And so it follows that x minus u is perpendicular to span of B. Okay, that proves the first part. Okay, second Bessel's inequality. Just use this relationship between the norm square and the inner product and expand. This is summation j equals 1 to n mod x uj uj. Second term I will use let us say r equals 1 to n x with ur. This is summation j equals 1 to n x with uj, summation j equals 1 to, r equals 1 to n x with ur, the whole thing goes with the conjugate. I can apply the conjugate to each of the terms, so, and then the rest is uj ur. You can do it either way. First look at this sum r equals 1 to n where j is fixed, and then the summation is over j. So when j is fixed, r takes a value j, this will be 1, all other terms are 0. So when r is equal to j, this will be x comma uj with a conjugate. Summation j equals 1 to n x comma uj into conjugate x comma uj bar. See, for the second sum r is a running index and r takes a value j is fixed. Now this is simply complex number into its conjugate, so modulus square. Okay, so that is the formula for norm u square. So if you know the coefficients, then you can compute its norm. Okay, we have a second inequality that we need to prove. Norm u square is less than or equal to norm x square, but remember that x minus u is perpendicular to u, that is from the first part. Use Pythagoras theorem. Norm x square is equal to norm x minus u plus u square. By Pythagoras theorem, this will be norm x minus u square plus norm u square. Okay. If you look at norm x minus u square, it is a non-negative number. So this is, I have added something non-negative. So that must be greater than or equal to norm u square. So norm x square is greater than or equal to norm u square. So norm x is greater than or equal to norm u, that is Bessel's inequality. Okay, use the fact that x minus u is perpendicular to u. U belongs to span of B. By definition, u belongs to span of B, that is what, that is why I could use the first part, x minus u perpendicular to u. Okay, third is immediate once we prove that x is equal to u. Okay, so let me I'll prove that here itself. I'll prove that x is equal to u. Then it follows from what we proved in 2 that these two hold. If I prove x equals u, then we know the formula for u that I have written down. This is a formula for u. So if x is equal to u, that first thing holds. If x is equal to u, from norm u square equal to summation modulus square, this follows. Okay, that's easy. Look at if let this be a basis for V, then span of B is V. Span of B is V. Till now it is not a basis. In 3, we are assuming it is a basis also. So span of B is V. Now what does the first part say? First part says x minus u is perpendicular to span of B. So x minus u perpendicular to V, which means x minus u inner product of that with V, this is 0 for all V in V. In particular, for V equal to x minus u, we get the following. X minus u must be 0, but x minus u is norm x minus u square. Okay, you can even use the thing from the inner product. So I'll say this is 0 from the positive definiteness of the inner product. It follows that x is equal to u, and so the third part follows. Okay, so if B is a basis, then span B is V is what is being used. Okay. This is just to develop a machinery for a particular problem that I mentioned briefly. The problem is the following. Often we consider the following situation. Given an inner product space, and a fixed vector, we seek a vector u in a subset W of V which approximates X. Given a fixed X in an inner product space and a subset W, among all the elements from that subset W, I want to choose a particular vector U which satisfies the property that it will serve as an approximation for the X that I started with. Okay. Let me give one or two examples. One example, motivating example from analytical geometry. Suppose I am given a vector, let us say 1, 2, 1 in R3. I want to find a vector on this plane. This is W. W is the set of all X in R3. Such that let us say x1 minus x2 plus x3 is 0. For example, we ask this question, what is the length of the projection from a point onto a plane? What is the distance of a point from a plane, etc. I have a point, this is x, this is my subset W, in this case it is a subspace. The point U can be thought of as an approximation to the point x. 1 to 1 already belongs. Change the equation. 1 to 1 is already there. So let's say this is my equation x1 plus x2 plus x3 is 0. The question is there a point u in W that will approximate x? From analytic geometry of 3 dimensions, we know that you need to just project x onto this plane. That projection onto W will give the vector u. That projection will give the vector u, will give the vector u. Let us also observe in this case that the vector x minus u is perpendicular to the plane. The vector x minus u is perpendicular to the plane. Okay. Remember what we proved in the first first part of the previous result. So these are related. X minus u is perpendicular to the plane because it is a projection. Okay. This is one motivating example. Sometimes in the space of functions, in the space of continuous function, let us say C01. We would be interested in approximating the exponential function in terms of just writing down as a linear combination of certain polynomials. Certain polynomials, you look at the subspace spanned by those polynomials, then I would like to write down the exponential function in that space. So what is the approximation to that exponential function in that subspace? This is another question. Okay. So let's pose this problem. We need to understand this meaning, approximation, and then see how this problem can be solved. Okay. See, in the finite dimensional case, this problem can be solved. In the infinite dimensional case, it's not. There are examples where the problem does not have a solution. Okay. But we'll confine our attention to the finite dimensional case. So let me rewrite this problem mathematically. The problem is given x and v, we need to determine, if possible, u in W such that, so it is an approximation. Approximation is given in terms of a norm induced by an inner product. Given x and v, to determine u such that norm of x minus u, this particular u, this norm should not exceed the norm of x minus w for all w. This is the problem. So it is not just an approximation, it is a best approximation in that sense. Such a u is called a best approximation. A best approximation to x, it also depends on the subset w. So it is a best approximation to x from w. This will obviously change if I change w. So I need to minimize this norm. I need to minimize norm x minus w for all w in w, to see whether there is a u in W that satisfies this condition. Okay. So, this is called the error of the approximation. Norm x minus u is called error of the approximation. Now, in many practical problems, this norm is the 2 norm, that is sum of squares or integrals of squares of functions. So this is in many instances called the least squares approximation. Squares approximation, and this vector u sometimes is also referred to as a projection of x onto w. There is a motivation coming from geometry, the problem that we considered just now. the vector U is a projection of X onto the subspace W. So sometimes U is called a projection of X. Okay, that's another terminology. In general, as I told you, in general, this U may not exist. It may not be unique. Okay, but for in the finite dimensional situation, the existence is there. The computation follows by using Gram-Schmidt process. Okay, so let me prove that result next, and go back to this problem and see how this problem can be solved by this method. So this proof is constructive, and the next theorem tells you how to construct the best approximation in case it is unique. So I have an inner product space. And X is a fixed vector. We need W to be a subspace. Let W be a subspace of V. Let U be a best approximation. To the vector X from the subspace W. See, what this also means is that U belongs to W. Among all the vectors in W, use the one that minimizes norm X minus W. Okay, so let U be a best approximation X from W, then X minus U with I will use W. This is equal to 0, X minus U must be perpendicular to W for all W in W. The converse also holds. That is, if U is a vector in W that satisfies this condition, then U must be a best approximation to X. Converse also holds. Okay, let me just write down. That is, if U element of W satisfies a converse, we also have the following. So I will call this 1. What we would like to have, okay. Ideally, if a best approximation exists, then it must be unique. That is always the case. Existence might be a problem, but if it exists, then it is unique. In the case of an inner product, in the case of a, see, this problem is posed as a problem involving norms. In the general nonlinear space, it may not exist, but if it is a norm induced by the inner product, in the general nonlinear space, it may not be unique. But if it's a norm induced by an inner product, if it exists, then it is unique. Okay, and second property, second part tells you how to construct this U. Let this be U1, U2, etc., UN. Be an orthonormal basis for W. So this last part assumes that W is finite dimensional, V can be infinite dimensional. Okay, there is no condition on V. V can be an possibly infinite dimensional inner product space. But if W is a finite dimensional subspace, then the last part tells you the formula for the best approach. Then U is summation j equals 1 to n x uj uj is the unique best approximation. Again, this should remind you of the formula for U that we defined earlier. Okay, so if W is a finite dimensional subspace of V, and if you have this orthonormal basis, then the best approximation to X is given by this explicit formula. Okay, you know X, you can compute these numbers, so this U can be determined. Maybe I will give an example. We will take the same example and use this construction given in 2 and then solve the problem and then come to the proof of this result. What is U that satisfies norm x minus u less than or equal to norm x minus w for all w in capital W? Probably we could look at the other methods of solving this problem. For instance, how would you solve this problem using techniques from analytical geometry of 3 dimensions? Do you remember? Yes.
Oh.
So we take U as any point like
alpha, beta, gamma.
Alpha, beta, gamma, then alpha, then we find the equation of line xu is using direction cosines like 1, 1, 1.
Okay.
Is a direction ratios.
Direction ratios.
So
yes.
We'll get an equation of line.
Okay, that is not enough.
Yeah. Then
we have
plane and line. X minus u is perpendicular to the plane. Yeah. So use that and then solve this problem. Okay, that's from analytical geometry. Can you use calculus? Because the minimization problem. So how?
Using the characterization x1 plus x2 plus x3 0 by using Lagrange method, we can find.
Yeah, you must use Lagrange multiplies. Okay. So you can use Lagrange multiplies method for functions of several variables to determine this minimum. Okay, you try both those methods and also the method that comes from applied linear algebra. Okay, what does this tell you? This last part tells you that you must first construct an orthonormal basis for W. Okay, let's consider a basis for W. See, this is the problem. The problem is to determine U that minimizes this distance, where X is this vector, W is this subspace. Okay, I want a basis, orthonormal basis for W. What is the dimension of W?
2.
So I need to determine 2 vectors. So let's call u1 as 0, 1, minus 1 and u2 to be 1, 0, minus 1. Both these vectors belong to W and they are linearly independent. One is not a multiple of the other. Okay, I shouldn't call it u1, u2. I'll call it a1, a2. u1, u2 is a notation for an orthonormal basis. Okay. So, a1, a2 is a basis. So, we need to apply Gram-Schmidt process. So for the first one, okay, for me u1 is 1 by root 2 into 0, 1, minus 1. Again, for convenience, I am writing the vectors as row vectors. This is u1, and what is u2? To determine u2, I must use w2. w2 is u2 minus, a2 minus a2 u1 u1. a2 is 1, 0, minus 1, minus a2 with u1. These two terms are 0, 1 by root 2. There will be another 1 by root 2, that is 1 by 2 into u1, 0, 1, minus 1. So that is 1, 0 minus 1 by 2, minus 1 plus 1 by 2, minus 1 by 2. So this is orthogonal to this, and the norm of this, so I can write this as, I will take minus 1 by 2 outside. Then it is minus 2, 1, 1. So that I get 1 minus 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2. V2 is, what is the norm of this? 1 by 4, 2 by 3, root 2 by 3 into W2. Minus 1 by root 6 into minus 2, 1, 1. That is, so this, I should call it u2. 4 plus 1 plus 1, so norm is 1, this is orthogonal to this vector. Okay, now determine u from the formula that is given here. X is 1, 2, 1, right? Okay. Call u as summation, so that is x. X is 1, 2, 1. X comma u1 plus x comma u2. X comma u1, these two. This goes with minus 1, just 1, 1 by root 2 into u1. u1 also has a 1 by root 2. Plus u2 goes with 1 by 6. In a product x with u2, that is minus 2, 1, 1. Minus 2, 1, those two get cancelled. I get just a 1 again into u2. u2 is minus 2, 1, just check if my sign is correct, minus, so that is taken care of. I should go with a minus 2, 1, 1. Okay, so that is minus 1 by 3, then 1 by 2 plus 1 by 6, 2 by 3. Minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 6, minus 2 by 3. The last term is minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 6, that makes it minus 1 by 2 plus 1 by 6. So this is 3 minus 1 by 3. So I can write this as 1 by 3, say minus 1 by 3. Into 1, 2, 1 minus 2, 1. This is my vector u. Okay. So you please go back and check that this is the vector that you would get by the Lagrange multipliers method and analytic geometry. Okay. Lagrange multipliers method is conditional extremum. conditional extrema. Minimize the distance between x and u subject to u being in a subspace. That is conditional extrema. Okay, in advanced calculus you must have studied. Okay, so let me stop here. I will prove this next time. Okay. Do you have any questions?
If the body is finite dimension, then you must exist. Suppose if you take a dimension W say in infinite dimension, then is it possible to exist or no?
No, you can give examples. It may not exist. But if it exists, it is unique in an inner product space. That is, in a nonlinear space induced by an inner product. In a general nonlinear space, it may not exist. In a general nonlinear space, it may exist, but it may not be unique. Okay. Okay.